Thank you. Hello, everyone. So first of all, as usual, I prefer a math conversation to a proper math talk. So I'm not interested in squeezing a lot of material down your throat. So whenever you feel like it and you have a question which is related to the talk, just ask away. So okay. So just one thing about Russ to start with. There are people who talk about big religious movements, and they characterize them as some of them being weight-oriented. They look for the weight in the religion. The others are more joy-oriented. So in the name of the, in the spirit of the place, for example, you could analyze
weight,
you know, like seriousness, you know, weight in the movement. So, for example, you could analyze rabbinism as more weight-oriented in Judaism, and how Hasidism, at least the start of Hasidism, as a more joy-oriented movement. And you could transfer this to probability theory. And in that sense, this whole school is a joy-oriented school of mathematics. At least that's what I experienced. I'm not a probabilist myself. Maybe I'm the only non-probabilist here who's giving a talk. I was born as a group theorist, and I was abused by probability in college, by classical probability professors, and then Balint actually was a classmate of mine in high school. Showed me what is nice in probability theory, and I'm still basking in its beauty. So definitely this school is joy-oriented and it's fun to observe. And in this school, Russ is a special, unique, mixture of joy and weight in mathematics. So it's, you're always, a source of amusement in a good way. So thanks. So that's about that, and actually this talk is an attempt to translate something that I would be thinking about normally in ergodic theory terms, something that you may not care about, to Russ's terms. So it's an attempt. Also, it's a joint work with Sam Mellick, my PhD student, and just deal with me. If you don't understand something or I'm saying something stupid, just call me in. Okay. So what we are dealing with today is the notion of cost. In the general setup, we can tell this. So most of what I will say will work for, G, a group. We are dealing with big groups here. So it's locally compact, second countable, unimodular, and non-discrete, non-compact. And that would be a good joke by itself, to tell you about joy-oriented mathematics and then write this sentence to the world. So just think about SL2R. Just a real Lie group, semisimple real Lie group. SL3R, or, SL2C. And you will be fine in this talk. So maybe you should think about, R square sometime. You will be fine. So you don't even have to understand these words. So we take such a group. We take one of these groups. We take a natural action. We basically consider two natural actions. Either the group acts on itself by left, or the group acts on its symmetric space. So it can be the orthogonal group acting on R square, or it can be SL2R acting on the upper half plane. So that's the setup. Now, we want to understand point processes. So by point process, I just mean a random discrete subset of the space that we are talking about, so symmetric space. And random discrete subset, which is such that the distribution is invariant under the action of the group. So an invariant random discrete subset. All right, does this make sense? You're with me? So it could be R squared type orthogonal group. It could be just R squared acting on itself. And then the results are somewhat different. Both are in the game. So, okay. So what we want to understand is the notion of cost. That's what the whole talk will be about. And cost asks you that if you have this point process, let's always assume that the point process we are talking about is ergodic. And you want to connect those dots with a graph. And the question is, what is the minimal amount of edges you have to pay for that? Okay, so you want to connect them as a graph. You want to build a connected graph on this point process. Is this connected graph, and you want to minimize the average degree of such a connected graph built on the process. Okay, and the infimum of this average degrees will be the cost of this process. It's that simple. Okay, that's the notion. So I wasn't very precise because, of course, first of all, I didn't tell you what does it mean average degree. And second, if I just want to build a graph on that thing, I can just start to connect farther and farther points and still make it connected, you know, and it looks like some kind of big tree. So this kind of any meaningful expected degree will be just one, you know, and that's the end of the story. However, I want to do it in an invariant way. So more than that, when I have this process, I want to do it as a factor of that process. So the real notion is I have this random configuration, and based on that random configuration, I deterministically want to build a graph on it, okay, such that this deterministic way doesn't know where the root of the space is. That's what invariance is. Okay, this automatically means that the distribution of these graphs will be also invariant under the group action. Happy?
It's not clear at all.
What is not clear at all?
What is this graph?
Okay.
Maybe in R2,
yeah, to make something. No. I never told you, okay? Yeah, okay? So what you want is that you can take this, to talk about a random point process, you're taking the space of discrete sets, on this fixed space. That makes sense. That's a nice topological space. It admits a G action by translation, and we are talking about an invariant probability measure. To talk about a random graph, you take the space of sets, discrete sets, with a graph structure. That also admits a G action. It's also a nice topological space, and you take an invariant measure there. You say that the second measure is a factor of the first measure if it's a factor, if it's a G-equivariant push-forward, the second measure of the third measure, okay? In geometric terms, it just means that I want you to produce a way, once I give you a configuration, give me a deterministic way to draw a graph on it, which doesn't care where the root of the space is. That's what means that it will be invariant. Or when the orthogonal group acts, it also doesn't care if I rotate the situation, right? And there is also this requirement that it should be a measurable map, but we don't worry about that, and usually you don't have to. So does this make sense now? Let's have a stupid and a not so stupid example. And yeah, go ahead.
What are you trying to minimize in the end?
Now, once I do it invariantly, I can do the following. I can take this space, I can fix some u. I fix a hard measure on g. That's important. So fix the hard measure, mu, okay, on g, or on this symmetric space, because there can be many hard measures. They are multiples of each other, but fix one. And take some fixed, subset with measure 1. Okay, once this is fixed in the space. Now I look at my random graph. My random graph is evolving here, and I'm just counting the out degree, you know, the sum of the degrees of the points in the set. And I take the expected value of that. This is the expected degree of the graph. You can easily prove that this will not depend on the actual u. you know, if you do it on any test thing, it gives you the same thing because the hard measure is unique. That's what it really is. Okay? So.
I don't think you have said that you want to make the graph connected.
I think I said that. Did I say that? Yeah.
This is the only thing I
understand. I mean. We will have examples and okay, so let's write a definition. So P is a point process. Okay, so definition. P is a point process. On G, or on the symmetric space of G, doesn't matter. And then you take, you know, the cost of P, you define it as the infimum, okay? And now you take infimum, you take all possible factor graphs, defined on the discrete set, and then you take the expected degree, which is just the expected sum of the degrees of G in X, where you sum on U intersection P, okay? So you take this random subset P, you intersect it with U, and you add up the degrees there. And you take expected value. What? G is big group. The graph is, well, it has to connect an infinite set. So hopefully not. So in order to make this meaningful and nice, you have to take out the density of the set. That's the right thing to do. So then you take out E of just the intersection, the expected intersection of U and P, okay? And you have to take a 1/2 here. Okay, so that's what you do. Okay, that's a very natural thing. Basically, what you do, you take U, you intersect it with G.
That's notational. G was also the initial group.
Oh, that's what caused the confusion. That's my bad. Yeah.
So one of them should become.
One of them should become what?
Gamma. The group should become. Yeah.
I cannot allow that. Benji, can we allow that? This cannot happen. It's like, no. I mean, the world can collapse and it won't be a gamma. It can be a whatever else, you know, like H. Are you happy with an H?
So H is the graph or the group?
H is the graph. G is the big group, always. Okay? So I think I'm good here. Okay, so. So again, what I just do, I just take this invariant random graph on the space, and I look at how it meets U. I even count the points outside just for the edges, and I count half the number of edges here minus the number of vertices inside.
The is going outside?
No, even the inside edges I can. I count everything, okay? So this is not spectral. This is not Cheeger stuff in that sense, okay? So I do that. And then I take all possible factor graphs and I try to make it as small as possible. So I'm trying to give this process a diet, you know, like because it's too fat, I'm to give it a diet in the best way. Okay?
If you don't require to be a factor map but allow auxiliary randomness, can it get smaller?
Yeah. It could get. I tell you the main question of this area and you will see that my answer. So the answer of big problem is whether any two free processes, a process is free if the corresponding group action is free, meaning that almost surely your random discrete set has no symmetries in the group, allow no symmetries in the group. Does this make sense? So question, big question, does every free process or do all free processes? Yeah. I'm not just not a probabilist, I'm also not a native speaker. So do all three processes have the same cost? Okay. This is an open problem. I really don't know how to solve this. This is not fixed. This is not the fixed price question. It's the analog for a fixed group. Fixed group, fixed hard measure. Yes. Yes.
What did free mean? I'm sorry.
Free means that the action is the corresponding action is free, which just means that if you take a random with respect to this distribution, you take a random discrete subset, it almost surely has no periods. There is no element of G that fixes it as a set. Okay? So we don't know a counterexample. Yes. It doesn't depend on U. That's easy to show. It's just uniqueness of hard measure. It does depend on the hard measure. You have to fix the hard measure to meaningfully talk about the hard measure of things. But that's only unique up to scale in general. No. We also don't know. So,
yeah. There are many free processes for the fixed group.
Yes.
Let me conjecture it.
Actually, this is cost comes from Gilbert Levitt, the notion. Most of the deep work was done on it by Damian Gaborio on for discrete groups, and the analog of this question is the fixed price question, which is also open for discrete groups. I don't want to talk about discrete groups now, but it's also an open question, and this is not this is an even stronger question. So this is a generalization, and I try to tell you very clearly why I ask this. I have a specific reason. Yes.
For these point processes, do you have these issues like uniform and non-uniform lattices?
No. So no, you don't have to worry about it.
You can never have.
Don't worry about it. Yeah, the Poisson is fine. You can talk about. Also, you don't worry about that. That would be a good question. So let me ask, you know, does it matter how far you want to connect? I mean, how long are the edges? You don't care about that either. You just don't care.
So could you tell us what is the cost of the Poisson process on the plane?
Yes. No. I can tell you that it's yes and no. I can tell you something about it. Oh, on the plane, just on the cost of the Poisson process on the plane, it will turn out that the cost of the Poisson process on the plane is just one. Sorry, zero. Because what I defined is not the cost, it's the cost minus one. I'm sorry. And I want to talk about cost minus one because cost minus one is the real invariant. Otherwise, in every statement that I said, I have to take out one, minus one, and that's how it becomes natural. So it's zero. So how do you do that on the plane? I don't show you how to do the Poisson, but you will see soon that this is true. Okay, it's not entirely clear how to do directly the Poisson. Okay, however, you know the on the Poisson?
And the Poisson,
yeah. I guess that there are many, many ways to show that this is just zero.
It's so tree,
what? For the tree, yes. Yes.
Minimum spanning
does the job. It's perfect.
But why does it give you the
why is the expected degree 2?
No,
of a expected degree is 2, and then you subtract one here and subtract another one.
But in the plane,
Yeah, that's one way to prove it, and there are at least four other ways to prove this. So this is easy. So for amenable groups, actually, this is easy. For amenable groups, this is true. Okay? So true for amenable groups. It's always zero. It just zeros out. That's not what I meant by joyful math, you know. So, yeah. Okay, so, all right. So that's the notion. Let's get a bit familiar with it. So let me drag you to the unknown and you know, fearful places of group theory. Because I know that you want to be there. Yes? That's the stupid example, okay? So stupid example where it's not a free process, it's so much not free that you just take a lattice in G. So So example, gamma in G is a lattice, meaning a discrete subgroup with finite covolume. The Cohar measure is finite, the quotient space has finite Haar measure. And then you just take what you can do. You can take a random translate of gamma according to this normalized Haar measure. Okay? That's a nice invariant random discrete subset. So random translate. However, you know, there is really not much randomness in that guy. Meaning, if I give you the position of a point, you know the position of all the rest of the points because they are just the gamma translates of it. So any factor of that system is also really, really stupid. It basically can say, hey, connect to this fixed guy, this fixed element of gamma, and connect to that fixed element of gamma, and that's what it can do, and it has to do the same everywhere. Okay? So what you will get is just some subset of gamma, and you connect everyone to its, you know, to its S neighbor, which is something you have seen. This is a Cayley graph, and this will be connected if and only if S generates gamma. Okay? So the cost is really just the minimal number of generators of gamma, except that, you know, this lattice will not have covolume 1, so you have to divide it. So actually, when you write out the computation, then you get that the cost minus 1 of this equals the minimal number of generators as gamma minus 1 over the volume of G mod gamma, the covolume of gamma. Maybe like this, okay? So, and actually that's the notion that's how I came into this notion. That's the invariant I'm interested in since high school almost. So I want to understand how to generate a group. That's my bing. Okay? So in particular, a lot of my work in mathematics was revolving around understanding estimating minimal number of generators. So the stuff that I was after, and here comes something that I hope you can follow most of it, and you know, this is where we need some dialogue, I think. So what we analyzed in previous papers is that you have, forget about big groups and G, just take a finitely generated group gamma and take a chain of subgroups in it, okay? And then you look at this invariant. You look at the limit of d of gamma n minus 1 divided by the index of gamma n in gamma. You can prove that this limit exists because it's a non-increasing sequence by Nielsen-Shire theorem. So it admits a limit, and you call this the rank gradient. And there was a theorem of myself and Nikolov, followed by a lot of similar theorems, where we express this limit as the cost of the corresponding profinite action. So I'm not even writing the correct form, it's the cost of the profinite limit. Okay? And minus one. Yeah, thank you. And it cost minus one of the profinite limit. And this allows you to play back and forth between cost and rank gradient, and you can prove nice theorems in the discrete setting, but we are not going there. I'm just telling you that the next thing I wanted to understand is when these don't form a chain. Or more generally, when they are not even commensurable as groups, they just sit in the same Lie group as lattices. This is one of the most fruitful ways you can connect two groups. So the general question, okay, so G is a Lie group. G is any of these groups, and you have a bunch of subgroups, lattices, and then you want to look at the limit of the of gamma n minus 1. The minus 1 is for aesthetic purposes, really, over the volume of gamma n. You want to know whether it exists, how much is it, etc. Now, once you start to study this question, you bump into natural counterexamples that this limit can depend on the sequence. However, all these counterexamples are artificial, And it turns out that this is intimately connected with Benjamin-Disham convergence. I will call it Benjamin-Disham convergence from now on. But there are many names on it. So if you, in fact, the conjecture is that when the quotient space, the quotient Riemannian manifold, G mod gamma n, Benjamin-Disham converges to G as a Riemannian manifold, so weak sampling converges, then this sequence converges. In fact, it's an invariant of G. Okay, so conjecture. It may not be clear why, how what this have to do with Poisson processes, but it will be clear in the next 2 minutes. Okay, so conjecture it, for BS convergent sequences. This guy converges, and it converges to an invariant of G. And actually, we conjecture that for semisimple Lie groups, this limit should be zero. Except for SL2R, where it's non-zero. Okay? And for SL2R, you can actually prove this. So that's the question or conjecture. Now, what does this have to do with processes? I mean, I'm talking about dumb, really dumb, you know, very deterministic point processes. So what the heck? I tell you what the heck. Well, heck is a fish, actually, in Hungarian. But I guess it's not a fish in English, is it? All right. So you take these spaces, okay? So this is G over gamma 1, G over gamma 2, G over gamma n, okay? And you want to relate this minimal number of generators of each other. So to do that, you want to build some kind of nerve complex. If you feel like I'm swearing, don't worry about it. You want to build some nerve complex that actually pushes down the rank to where you want to push it down. To build this nerve complex, you need some defining points to build it. So what you want to do, you want to simplicialize it. Okay? You want to build this. Huh?
What do you mean by nerve complex?
I mean that you take a subset of it, which is, an R-net, or any subset, and then you build a simplicial complex using that. You build edges, and basically you build a...
intersection?
Yeah, using the intersection. So, and then that gives you an upper bound for the rank, and that's what you would need. Okay? But what do you use for? In order to connect these two models of G, you have two Benjamin-Disham good models of G, you want to connect their, you know, this kind of complex that you build on it. What you really need, it turns out, when you go into it, it's all about invariant processes. Actually, what you need is an invariant process at the limit, which is G or the symmetric space as you want, which can be modeled with a small error on both spaces. Okay? In the Benjamin-Disham sense. Okay? So what you want is an ideal process at infinity, which is free, a very free process, but you can still, on any good model of the Lie group, you can more or less mimic it with some small error. Because once you do it, you can copy this cost business. You know, if you can build a factor graphing, which is very narrow, you can mimic it on this finite model. The model believes that he is infinite, you know. At most points, he looks infinite or arbitrarily large and just mimics the factor graph, and it will be good with some small error. Okay? So the only such process that I know that serves as a common model for all the good models of G is the Poisson process and the factors of Poisson process. This could even be turned into a theorem. For SL2R, I wonder whether this is a theorem. You can actually ask this in a meaningful way. I'm not going there. Whether the Poisson and the factors of Poisson are the only processes that can be modeled on you know, on finite volume, you know, modular spaces. But and we don't know a counterexample at least. Anyways, that's what made me interested in that. Out of simple necessity, the Poisson process is the only one I can model anywhere. I just have to pick many independent points. Actually, what I would prefer to use sometimes is not the Poisson process itself. I don't have to explain what the Poisson process is, right? Right, okay. So, but as a factor of the Poisson process, you can get a more visible process. You can get a random R-net for some parameter R, what you do, you have this Poisson process, you have a parameter r, you just weed out the points, randomly you erase the points, you know, for a pair of points, if one of them is too close to the other, you erase one of them. Then you toss another Poisson and keep doing that. At the end, all the sites will be occupied and you will find an R-net, a random R-net. This is something that in the discrete setting I first heard from Russ, and in the discrete setting you can use similar methods. Okay? So as a factor of the Poisson process, you can build a very robust and very random R-net. Now that has the advantage that it's an R-net, so it's quasi-isometric to the space, so you may be able to see it better than the Poisson, which has arbitrary large holes and very dense places, which screws up both spectral theory and homotopy theory. It turns out that it doesn't matter which one you're playing with, because further back, these further weakly factors back to the Poisson. So you can play with the Poisson if you want. You can play with this random R-net if you want. It will give you the same result. Okay. So let me state some partial results with Sam. We have with Sam. That was the motivation. Now we just go back to the original notion of cost. So the first thing is that you know the cost minus one is monotonic with respect to factor maps. And by that, I mean factor processes. So if you take a factor process, it can only increase the cost. I will hand wave a proof of that, but let me state some of the theorems. Second theorem is that you can take a weaker notion than factors. Factor is actually, it's not so easy to factor a process on another process in general, Poisson's notwithstanding. So I also allow you to do something much more milder. I allow you to take your process P and just take a sequence of factors, a sequence of factor processes, and take the weak limit. Okay? Take the weak star limit. This is called weak containment. And this cost is still monotonic with respect to weak containment. This is a result that was in the discrete setting that was proved by Kakris. And the next theorem is that every free process weakly contains the Poisson. Poisson, you could ask which density, it doesn't matter. The Poissons are all weakly equivalent. Okay, so they are all the same. This means that in the discrete setting, this was a theorem of mine with Benji. Okay. What is funny that in both cases the proofs because I wanted to Russ-festivize the proofs that we had with Sam. It became much more transparent. I understand the proofs much more than I did before. So I will hand wave the proofs. But okay, so everyone weakly contains the Poisson, which means that the Poisson has the maximal cost among all the point processes. So if you want to prove that something vanishes, the rank gradient vanishes, all you have to deal with really is just the Poisson process. If the Poisson vanishes, every guy vanishes. You're happy. It's the Bernoulli, not the Poisson. Yeah? That's the poor man's Poisson process. So let me tell you. I want to see if I want to tell you, state another theorem. No? I'm happy here. Just one more. So a particularly interesting question, what is the cost of Poisson on the hyperbolic free space, acting on by the isometric group? Okay. So we expect that this cost is cost minus 1 is 0. So you can give it a very healthy diet or unhealthy diet, as you wish. Then this implies that this is an unsolved problem for many decades, that the Higgard genus of a hyperbolic free manifold over the rank of the hyperbolic free manifold can converge to and can be arbitrarily large. Okay? There has been a lot of work on this. It was open for a long time whether they are always equal, these two quantities. This has been done by Tao Li in an ingenious paper. But all the methods, everything just gives you free halves. It never gets bigger than free half, the ratio of the Higgard genus and the rank for a hyperbolic free manifold. And this would give you, through a series of results, that this can actually tend to infinity. So it would really asymptotically separate the two interesting invariants. Okay? I'm not going to go into why this is true. It goes through all this machinery of Benjamin-Schramm convergence and work of Leckenby on free manifolds. Nevertheless, it would be interesting to see it. No, no.
Depends on the assumption that cost minus 1 is 0.
Yes, yes. If it's 0, then this implies this. This is still an open. It's not only open for hyperbolic free manifolds, it's open for free manifolds in general. Finite volume free manifolds.
But you assume, you think that the cost minus 1 is always 0 for all these manifolds?
Not the manifold, just hyperbolic space, the Poisson on the hyperbolic space. I don't know what to think. If you force me to conjecture something, I would go for it. I would say that it's zero. If it's not zero, well, you can actually show free processes on hyperbolic space which have zero costs. So then it screws the other question whether all free processes have the same cost. Okay, so. So then no to our own question, but that would be also very interesting. So that's a crucial case, and this is a case that I really don't have any idea how to do this. You know, like, be my guest. You can so write me an email or send me the archive or something. I mean, I'm trying this for some, yes. Okay, H2, you can have a kind of lazy proof. You can connect this to cohomology. And you can prove that on H2 the cost is bigger than cost minus 1 is bigger than 0 using homological L2 Betti number stuff. And that's not very transparent at this level of conversation for us. So let me pose another question, which would solve it in a very convincing and Russ-like way. Okay? The question is whether any point process on the upper half plane is a weak limit of periodic point processes. Okay, so is every free point process on H2 a weak limit of periodic processes? The corresponding theorem for free groups, which is the discrete analog of SL2R, is true. And it was proved by Lewis Bowen. It's a beautiful discrete setting. It's Bowen's theorem. Every invariant measure on the free group is the weak limit of periodic measures. A periodic process is that you take a finite index subgroup, or in this case, a lattice, yes, and you shift it. And this is something that I didn't say. Very good that you reminded me. So what's going on? This would have been apparent if I started with the proof of this weak containment. So let me remind myself. Actually, what you're always playing with in proofs is not the point process itself, but labeled point processes. You just don't want just random points. You put random labels on it. So you can prove, if you just care about weak containment, one of the results that we proved with Sam is that for every free process, it weakly contains the free process with an IID on it, with IID random labels on it. So you can IID-ize three processes. I'm sorry, Benji. And because of that, you can take further factors. And by, now by factors, I also mean that it's that it can use the information written on the labels. And this allows you a lot of freedom. Okay? So for every free process, you can play with the process, or you can just put IID labels on it. Okay? A periodic point process is just that you have a lattice, okay, and you take the quotient space, you take some random subset of that place, and you pull it back to the symmetric space. Okay? So this means that, you know, this configuration is almost surely the configuration is periodic with respect to this fixed lattice. That's what a periodic process is. Okay? Does this make sense? I lost a bit of the audience. Yeah? Yeah?
How is the Poisson process on H2 a weak limit of such periodic process?
I don't know. That's why it's a question.
So you
want to do that one example, I could do it. But I don't want to because I'm running out of time. And actually, it's a question. But first of all, this question, I'm not sure whether the answer is true or false. I would like it to be true. That would be the nice answer. So, because for graphs, what you do, what Louis Bowen does, you can build abstract graphs because any deregular graph lifts to the deregular tree. So you have a lot of freedom when you want to lift processes. Now, this is not true for SL2R. You have a lot of, quotients of SL2R, but not as much as quotient graphs of the tree. So what you want to find is some kind of finite model, finite volume quotient of SL2R, which with a small error models your process, your free process. And, you know, I definitely don't see how to do it, although I see very clearly how to do the graph case. So you cannot just connect stuff there. It's like and make a manifold. So I leave it at that. Let me hand wave these two things.
The correlation of the free process, does this answer Jeff's question about computing the cost if you add randomness?
Actually, once you know, it doesn't. But if you can prove this, then this helps you to translate back the cost of a periodic process to the rank, to the minimal number of generators of the corresponding lattice. And in SL2R, we know very well how the rank behaves because of homology. The asymptotic behavior of the rank is very transparent. And this is what would finish the proof in a nice way, in a reasonable way, without having to do L2 cohomology. I'm not against L2 cohomology, just, you know, for me, that would be a more conceptual way. And this was this was actually the way Kekris gave an alternate proof for the fixed price for the free group, which was Damien's breakthrough theorem. So, in the discrete setting. So, okay, but I think this question is interesting in itself, even without cost. You know, just prove that an invariant point process is a weak limit of periodic ones. That's a reasonable problem. Okay, so let me hand wave. What's going on for factors. I will not go into weak containment. So I have a point process. These are the P factors onto Q. This is P. P are these guys. And Q are the crosses. Okay? So there are these two point processes. I want to show that the cost increases while non-decreases by taking this factor map. Okay? So what I do, that just means that if I have a cheap way of generating Q, that also gives me a cheap way of connecting P. So let me draw that cheap way of generating Q. Okay, so I have this cheap way of connecting Q. Now I take the Voronoi cells of these guys, of these points in Q. Those are not exact Voronoi cells, but you know, stay with me. And now, in each point, there are technical difficulties, but you connect the guy to its closest Q point, and then you connect every other guy, every other P guy, to this point with a tree, spanning tree, or just a star, or whatever you want. Okay. Now, after that, this is a matching. So in every Voronoi cell, there is one guy, except if that Voronoi cell intersects P is empty, then you don't worry about it. There is a guy in Q which does connect the graph, so you just mimic this connection. Now you, with the new graph, you take the pair of this guy and you connect them. Okay? And you do it all, you know, this is an invariant way of connection and it connects the graph. Since every point of P belongs to a Voronoi cell, so if you take 2 points of P, that Voronoi cell will be connected in the Q setup, so the connections will happen over here too. That's the proof. For taking weak limits, that's more technical and there are more, I would have to lie much more. So I lied a little bit because why is there a unique closest point and stuff like that? So why are the Voronoi cells have zero measure boundary? You know, those kind of beauties. Okay. So the next thing is that every free process weakly contains the Poisson. This is a pretty similar argument. So what you do is first of all you prove that every free process P weakly contains its own IID. Okay? Meaning it's the same process, just there are extra IID labels on the points. Why is that? This is a theorem that in the discrete setting I proved it Benji. So what you do is that you take this point process. And first, as a factor of that process, you define some epsilon net. You take two parameters, epsilon and some big R. Okay? So R tends to infinity. Epsilon doesn't even have to tend to zero. Epsilon has to tend to zero for non-discrete processes. So let's take epsilon tends to zero, R tends to infinity. You take an epsilon net, a random epsilon net, then you color it with many, many colors, but finitely many colors, such that any two points with the same color are at least R apart. You can do that as well as a factor. Okay? Now you take the Voronoi cells and color the Voronoi cells with the color coming from the net, from the epsilon net. Okay? And now for each color, you independently choose 0 or 1. And that gives you a two-partition, a random two-partition of the space. And now what you do, that every point in the original process inherits its color, the color of its Voronoi cell, the Voronoi cell is where it falls into. Okay? Now the thing is, when you look at a finite configuration of points, once R is much bigger than the diameter of that guy, you know, two guys, they both lie in some epsilon net Voronoi cell, they are far enough, so they cannot lie in the same cell, but they also can't have the same color because the colors are very separated. Which means that what you see there is independent zero ones, and you know, law of large numbers give you that this process will be close to IID. So the weak limit of those guys will be just the full IID on 0, 1. Of course, you can enrich randomness by not doing 0, 1 values, but...
Can you color 0, 1?
What?
Randomness?
Say it again. No, you don't. You don't. It's a deterministic random coloring. I start to feel like a probabilist. Okay. No, it's not. It's an actual coloring, and you want a sequence of deterministic colorings, but you choose them at random. You don't add randomness to the process. Okay? So that gives you this theorem. And then once you can IIDize, but oh, it's done. One more sentence. Then you just take the process, take its Voronoi cells, and in each Voronoi cell, independently use the randomness written on the number to mimic the Poisson process inside with some error. The weak limit of those will be the Poisson. So that's it. Okay, thank you very much.